Dear participants, welcome to the webinar Hydrodynamic Modeling on the Northwest European Shelf and North Sea, New Opportunities with Delphi CD Flexible Mesh. This webinar is broadcasted to you by Deltares Academy. My name is Erik de Goede and I'm one of the Delphi CD Flexible Mesh project leaders. Today I have the pleasure to announce the webinar speaker. First, a few facts and figures about this webinar. In total, about 1,200 people worldwide have showed interest. About 500 people from 71 countries have registered for this webinar. Again, welcome to you all. During this webinar, our panel is ready to answer your questions via text by clicking on questions in the GoToWebinar environment. After the webinar presentation, there's an opportunity to ask verbal questions to the presenters. In this webinar, we will focus on operational tide surge models of the Northwest European Shelf and in particular of the North Sea. The speaker of today is Firmijn Seil. He is a senior researcher at Deltares with more than 10 years of experience in hydrodynamic modeling. He has been involved in many hydrodynamic studies, both in the Netherlands and abroad. He is one of our key experts in the field of tide surge modeling and environmental hydrodynamics. Firmijn was responsible for the development of the latest generation North Sea operational forecasting models. These models will be presented in this webinar. I will now give the webinar floor to Firmijn Seil of Deltares.
Thank you, Erik. Welcome, everyone. Welcome again. This webinar basically deals with hydrodynamic modeling on the Northwest European Shelf, and in particular the North Sea and adjacent shallow seas and estuaries. Hydrodynamic modeling has many applications, but here the main focus will be on tide surge modeling. I'll start with a brief outline of the webinar. In the first half of the webinar, I will talk about the continuous development and improvement of the official Dutch operational tide surge models. I'll present a completely redesigned DCSM version 6 model, as well as the further refined DCSM Zuno model, and also show the importance of sufficient resolution depending on the relevant local spatial scales. Furthermore, I will mention some aspects that were crucial in achieving state-of-the-art model scale, and these are a rigorous reduction in uncertainty in the time-independent parameters, as well as the development of a steady-state Kalman filter to increase predictive quality for the shorter lead times. In the second half of the webinar, I will address new opportunities that Delphi 3D Flexible Mesh offers. I'll start with the conversion of these models for the acceptance testing of flexible mesh, and also mention some grid optimization that is made possible due to the unstructured character of flexible mesh. And finally, I will say something about the development of a 3D transport model for the same area and also discuss the potential benefits of using this 3D model even for storm surge forecasting. First, something on the history and the importance of real-time forecasting in the Netherlands. There's many different applications. For example, on a daily basis, it is important for say port operations and to ensure maritime safety on busy shipping routes towards, for example, Antwerp, Rotterdam and other ports in the area. Also nowadays, there's more and more geodetic applications for which accurate tide surge models are used. But for the coastal regions in the Netherlands, it is crucial, especially since large areas of the land lie below sea level. And during storm surges, the importance of providing precise and reliable warnings is only enhanced by the presence of movable barriers, such as the Eastern Scheld Barrier and the Maasland Barrier in the Rotterdam Waterway. These barriers require the decision to close to be taken in advance and only when strictly necessary. So far about the importance. In the past, we also had forecasting models, and one of the most important models there was the Dutch Continental Shelf Model version 5. This covered the largest domain. This model was originally developed in the 1980s and has been through numerous improvements ever since. But after a big storm in November 2006, the All Saints storm, it was decided that further improvements of water level forecasting were required. But given the lack of spatial resolution 8-9 kilometers at a time. Further improvements based on this version 5 model should not be attempted. So it was decided to completely redesign both the operational models and the operational framework. So in other words, what I present here, the models I present here, are part of a more comprehensive development to upgrade the operational forecasting system for the North Sea, including the operational framework. Many of you will be familiar with the North Sea, but say to briefly introduce you with the main characteristics of this water body, I have included an animation. On the left you will see the tide and the surge, the total water level, and on the right the surge only. I'll start the animation. Yeah, there it goes. On the left you can clearly see the tide traveling along Ireland to the north of Scotland and then further along the eastern UK coast towards the Netherlands and further along Germany, etc. What is also clearly visible is the slowing down of the tide propagation on the shelf and also the simultaneous amplification of the tide amplitude there. And finally, you can clearly see two amphidromic points in the southern North Sea. So far about the system characteristics. Then I'll move on to the model setup. On the right-hand side, you can see the spatial coverage and the bathymetry of the new model. With a blue dashed line, the extent of the previous generation model shown. So you can see that the extent is a lot larger. The model has a uniform cell size of 1.5 minute in east-west direction and 1 minute in north-south direction, and that roughly translates to 1 by 1 nautical mile. In total, we have around 1 million active computational cells. Even though we refined this new generation model substantially by a factor of 5 compared to the previous generation, in the Dutch estuaries and Waddenzee, the version 6 computational grid is still relatively coarse compared to the variability in geometry and bathymetry there. And we think that increased model resolution is essential for improving the representation of higher harmonics and also nonlinear tide surge interaction. So therefore, we have increased the resolution in the southern North Sea, in this case by a domain decomposition approach. So in the outer area, shown in green on the right-hand side, you still see the DCSM version 6 grid, and this is coupled dynamically with a curvilinear grid shown in blue of the ZUNO domain, which stands for Southern North Sea. And this has a variable grid size of up to 250, 400 meters in the estuaries and the Bonner Sea. Then something on the boundary forcing. There's open boundaries to the north, the west, and the south. We prescribe water levels there at 205 sections, and at the end of these sections, water levels are imposed and interpolated linearly in between them. The water levels are imposed in two parts. The first one is the tide and the second is the surge. The tide is defined in the frequency domain and we currently use 38 constituents, and these include many, say, diurnal and semi-diurnal constituents, also some higher harmonics and some lower frequency constituents as well, amongst which is the SA solar annual constituent, which is actually much less gravitational than and more meteorological and baroclinic in nature, but still we prescribe this as a barotropic forcing. The second part, the surge, for that we use an inverse barometer correction. So this means that the surge on the boundary is dependent on the time and space varying local atmospheric pressure, and this approach works well for deep water. For surface forcing, we use wind speed and air pressure as provided by the Heerlam numerical weather prediction model, which is provided operationally by the KNMI, the Royal Dutch Met Office. To translate the wind speed to surface stress, the sea surface roughness is calculated. For that, we use a Charnock relation with a Charnock parameter of 0.025. And this value is exactly the same as is used in the Heerlam NWP model. And this implies enhanced consistency in the RC boundary layer description. And this consistency, we found that this is essential in say, achieving optimal results. Then some miscellaneous characteristics. We use tide generating forces, so tidal potential, since the whole domain is quite large. Also in the higher resolution models, we use river discharges, but also barrier closures for 8 storm surge barriers and sluices, since we found that not only upstream of the barriers, but also downstream of the barriers, this has an impact on water levels. Then on to the calibration approach. First, I'll mention the data that is that we had available for calibration and validation. We have used both space-borne radar altimeter data, actually harmonic constituents derived from these data. These are shown in the green dots on the left-hand side. And we also have in situ tide gauge data at more than 100 locations. What is nice about these data sources is that they are complementary. The altimeter data has very good spatial coverage, but is less accurate in shallow water and also does not include the surge, since we use the harmonic constituents. On the other hand, the tide gauge data is much more accurate in shallow water and also includes the surge, but the disadvantage is that it is mostly confined to coastal areas. So I'll briefly show the altimeter data. In the upper plots, you can see the M2 amplitudes on the left and the phases on the right, as we know them from the Topex, Poseidon, and JSON missions. And as you can see, these provide a very nice spatial picture of the tide propagation and amplification. This is for M2. We also have these for other constituents. In the figures below, the model results are shown in the background, and the colored dots in these figures represent the values of the altimeter data at the crossover locations. So we only use the crossover of the ascending and descending tracks. So if you compare these data with the measurements, so if there's no color difference, that means there's a good agreement, and this is what you indeed see. So based on these results, we basically conclude that the tide representation adjacent to the open boundaries is well represented in the model. But nonetheless, we would like an even better quality, also more inside the model domain, and also the surge is not considered here. So in the next step, the tide gauge data is used to further improve the water level representation. For this further optimization, we have used the open source data assimilation toolbox OpenDA, and specifically the DUT algorithm for minimizing least squares. We have already seen that the areas adjacent to the open boundaries were well represented. So we have decided to exclude the prescription of the tide at the open boundary from the optimization problem. But nonetheless, we still saw errors being introduced during the tidal propagation. And these were quite significant. So we want to improve that. As depth levels and bed roughness are identified as the parameters with the largest uncertainties related to tide propagation, these are considered here for improved estimation with DUT. The control parameters are defined between the tide gauge locations. This is shown on the right-hand side of this slide. So in all of these different boxes, the bathymetry or the bottom friction can be adjusted. we did multiple experiments, multiple optimization runs with increasing length and number of parameters. For example, we used very long periods to account for non-stationarity of tidal amplitudes and phases, and also larger and larger areas to account for the spatial interactions between the different water bodies, because once the accuracy increases, smaller and smaller effects play a role in achieving optimal results. So in the final experiment, we used 200 control parameters, 12-month, say, full one-year runs, and more than 100 observation locations. This was a huge computational exercise. So then, of course, the question is, did this pay off? I want to say something about that in this slide. We did a validation shelf-wide with all the, say, the data that I have shown in the before. But here I'll focus on the Dutch coastal conditions. Not necessarily, say, in the estuaries, but really along the coast. And I make two comparisons. The first one is with the previous generation version 5 model. Because, say, in general, it is very difficult to say something about the model quality that should result from a calibration. But the least that you could demand from a new model is that it is at least as good as the previous model. And as you can see, this was more than met. We see an impressive improvement in total water level representation of almost 50%. And especially in the tides, you see an improvement of more than of almost two-thirds. Also, without comparing it to other models, a tide RMS error of 3 to 4 centimeters is very low for any model, and especially for such a large system where the results are not constrained by what is imposed on the boundaries. The second comparison is against is the refined model against the DCSM version 6 model, that is without the refinement. And these two models show somewhat, say the refined model shows somewhat better results, but it's, I would say it's roughly similar. But this is also sort of expected since the spatial variability, say in the southern North Sea, say the variability in geometry and bathymetry is already quite well resolved on the version 6 grids. But for other areas that might be different, and I'll show that later in the presentation. Here an example of some results for tide gauge station Wieringergronde in the north of the Netherlands. On the top you can see the tide for January 2007, which was a very stormy month. In the middle plot you see the surge, and below you see the total water level elevation. And also on the right hand side you see the corresponding scatter plots covering the entire year of 2007. And from this you can see there's a very good match between measurements and model results. But this is just one example. Then I'll move on and focus a bit more on the tide representation in the frequency domain. To say something about the tide, we do an harmonic analysis using more than 100 constituents, of which I only show the 8 major constituents plus M4 and M6 here. And the values shown here are averaged over the stations that I presented earlier. So of these constituents, only M2 shows an RMS amplitude error above 1 centimeter. So that's very accurate. The phase error shows somewhat larger variation over the constituents considered here. But crucially, the smallest phase error is in the largest constituent, so 0.8 degrees for the M2 tide. In the right-hand side column, I show the vector difference, which is basically a measure that combines the amplitude error and the phase error. And there you see that the constituent with the largest error is M2. 1.9 centimeters, which is expected because it has by far the largest amplitudes. Actually, between brackets, you see the results of the previous generation model. So you see a big improvement there. Then let's move on to some results in the Dutch Estuary and Bodensee. What I do here is I compare DCSM version 6 with the refined model, and what we see is that there is still a 25% improvement. This is mainly in the tides, presumably due to a better representation of the higher harmonics because of the higher resolution, but also what is noticeable that is that we still see an improvement in the surge representation of 12%. This might look small compared to the surge to the tide improvement, but still you have to I want to note that meteorological forcing is exactly the same. So presumably this improvement is due to a better representation of nonlinear tide surge interaction. Then again to the frequency domain for these stations. Also here the only constituent with an amplitude error is of more than 1 centimeter is M2. And again in the right hand column I show the vector difference with now in between brackets the unrefined version 6 model. And this clearly shows that that while the M2 representation has also improved with grid refinement, actually the largest absolute improvement can be found in the 4xDaily M4 constituent. So again, this shows that sufficient resolution is required to capture the higher harmonics and other nonlinear interactions. So, and these are mostly generated in shallow regions. Then onto the Kalman filter. We have now reduced uncertainty in the time-independent parameters, but there can still be significant uncertainty in the meteorological forcing, especially during storms. To tackle that, we have implemented a Kalman filter. And what this Kalman filter basically does is that, say, the difference between the model and the state of the system as known from observations is translated to an adjustment of the wind speed with a characteristic time scale. And this characteristic time scale ensures a smooth transition from, say, the hindcast to the predictive mode, and this also avoids inconsistency between wind forcing and the initial condition at the start of the forecast. Again, we use the open source data assimilation toolbox OpenDA, in which both an ensemble Kalman filter and a steady state Kalman filter are available. We started with an ensemble Kalman filter with 100 members and made a run on a dual hexacore machine for 15 days, and it took us 17 days. So that means for an operational system, this is not acceptable, since basically reality moves faster. But we have very good experience with steady-state Kalman filtering. So what we did is we computed the steady-state Kalman gain offline from these 100 members by averaging over a week, and we used this derived Kalman gain operationally with the steady-state Kalman filter. And this is computationally very efficient, so you have to think of, say, an additional 10-20% more computational time compared to the unassimilated model. So then onto the observation network, the Kalman filter locations. Say we know from past experience that there is only limited sensitivity to the Kalman filter parameter settings, so characteristic time scales and length scales, but what we know is very important is choosing the right observation network. I have shown here the 32 stations that we have eventually chosen, which say provides, as you can see, a very good spatial coverage, and especially important are the stations upstream of the area of interest, which in this case is the Dutch coast mainly, because these improve the accuracy of the forecast with sufficient lead time. And also, say we have 32 stations now, which is a lot more than say previous implementations. So this only enhances the redundancy compared to the old system. So now let's see whether this all paid off. We'll look at a validation of the Kalman filter implementation. First, by looking at a hindcast for 2007, again on the in the top table for the Dutch coastal stations, and in the bottom table for the Dutch estuarine and Bottensea stations. And what you can see there is that there is a very nice improvement, say 50% along the Dutch coast for the total water level representation. Of course, this is all in hindcast. But also hindcast results can be very important and especially useful for, say, providing boundary conditions for smaller scale nested coastal models. Also, these are results for the entire year of 2007, but of course, and for there's also some assimilation locations included. So we also want to see whether the Kalman filter also has a beneficial impact at stations, say further upstream or outside the direct assimilation locations. So for that, I will use this slide, which is an example from the Western Scheldt, an estuary mouth of a river in the south of the Netherlands. And what we see here is the modeled surge without assimilation, so the deterministic results on the left-hand side, and with Kalman filter, the assimilated result on the right-hand side. And from top to bottom, we go further upstream in the Western Scheldt. Only the top station, Vlissingen, is an assimilation station. During the storm that I show here, the November 2007 storm, which was a major storm that hit the North Sea, during this storm we see an underprediction of the surge without the Kalman filter. But with the Kalman filter on the right-hand side you see that it disappears. But also crucially, while we see this underprediction propagating upstream without Kalman filter on the left-hand side, with assimilation this disappears, not only in assimilation station Vlissingen, but also up to Antwerp. So this shows that the Kalman filter also works outside the assimilation locations. Previous examples were all in hindcast mode, but of course the real test of the applicability of a Kalman filter is also in the improved forecasts. So what we did is we looked at the forecast accuracy as a function of the lead time interval. In this case, we ran, say, around 1500 historical forecasts for the year of 2007. So every 6 hours, we did a forecast for 2 days and assessed the accuracy for each lead time interval with and without assimilation. In the top plot, you see the impact for the Dutch assimilation location. So you see a big impact for the hindcast, but still a beneficial impact up to say 12-18 hours, and also you see a beneficial impact at the independent locations. We have a further nice example, because when the new models were just operational, say the capability of the forecasting system, including the performance of its Kalman filter, was critically tested during the Xaver storm surge on 5-6 December, also called the Santa Claus storm in the Netherlands. Say on the top figure you see the deterministic results for tide gauge station Hoek of Holland, which is an important tide gauge location prediction location in the Netherlands. And this shows an underprediction during this event. say in the scatter plot you can easily see that. Say for this covers the entire year, so you see for the entire year in the scatter plot that in general the search say follows the diagonal, but the most extreme event is underpredicted as indicated by the tilt downwards with respect to the diagonal. Below you see the assimilated results, and there you see a much better match and also a close fit with a diagonal. But this was a hindcast for this important storm. More importantly, these results were also available and stored in the actual operational system, so we could later say also assess the lead time with which the positive impact of the Kalman filter was evident. Again, I take Hook of Holland as an example. What I show is the peak water level as actually occurred in the black line, and also as predicted by the deterministic and the assimilated model as a function of the availability before the occurrence of a peak water level. So at zero was the time of peak water level. These results, this figure shows that with the Kalman filter, an under prediction of 35 centimeters is reduced to just 10 centimeters in hindcast. But crucially, while a small positive impact is evident in the predictions operationally, say 12 hours before the peak water level, also the results available 6 hours before the peak water level show a very large improvement, in this case from minus 29 to minus 9 centimeters. So this is an excellent example of the benefit of using a Kalman filter during real storm surges. Then on to the, say, experience and advantages, new possibilities with Delphi flexible mesh. As part of the development of Delphi flexible mesh, we did a number of acceptance tests. And we chose a number of models, both marine models and fluvial models, but DCSM version 6 was one of them. And all acceptance tests are useful for their own specific features, but for DCSM this is related to the spatial extent to the model. And what I mean is that, say, much more than local coastal models, the solution of this model is less determined by boundary conditions and more by internal wave propagation. So that really tests the characteristics of flexible mesh. For this purpose, for the purpose of these tests, the purpose was to gain understanding of the differences introduced by switching to flexible mesh. So what we did here was a direct conversion. So no model improvement at this stage, and also no use of say new features of flexible mesh, so no use of the enhanced grid flexibility. I'll come back to that later though. So what you see here is the original results and the flexible mesh results as directly converted. You see that the surge is virtually the same. The tide is very slightly different, but not that different, especially compared to the big improvement that we earlier saw with the new generation model. And say these differences can be explained by the use of different advection schemes, for example, and can easily be resolved with a renewed calibration. So excellent results here. So, but of course, we now have flexible mesh. So, also the possibility to better match relevant local spatial scales. So, the challenge is there to improve the computational efficiency while maintaining the accuracy. So, what we did is we coarsened this model only where local spatial scales allow it. So, in this case, off the shelf, and we retained it in the more shallow areas where we have seen that, say, nonlinear interaction becomes important. Here you can clearly see the, say, the grid that resulted from this. I have tried to indicate that with colors, so the domain is exactly the same. And in red, the original grid size is retained. In blue, the intermediate area, the grid is 2 times coarsened in both directions, and in green, it is 4 times coarsened. And in between these areas, the grids are coupled with triangles. This has resulted in a reduction of the total number of nodes and links, say by a factor of 2.5 to 2. But there's also another aspect that could reduce the computational cost. Say the numerical accuracy is determined by the wave current number. This is proportional to the square root of the depth, and with the uniform grid size that earlier had, the deepest cells were limiting the computational time step. So now with this coarsening in the deeper areas, we could also increase the maximum allowed numerical time step from 120 seconds to 2 minutes to 200 seconds. And this combined, so the reduction in total number of cells and the increase in time step, meant that the model is 3 to 4 times faster, which is really significant, especially for operational applications. But also, crucially, it's not only faster. If we look at the results, we see that the search representation for the coastal Dutch coastal station is exactly the same. There's only a very, very minor deterioration of the search representation. So nice results, a lot faster, but of course, if it's faster, we also want this to spend this additional available computational time on other nice things. So we thought, okay, let's further increase the resolution in the southern North Sea, for example, along the Dutch coast in the estuaries. In the picture I show here, we have refined it up to a factor of 4. And crucially, this only led to an increase, again, in computational cost of only, say, 10-20%. So that is really, really limited, and means that with flexible mesh, we can more easily refine wherever we want it and wherever we think that it is required. Then on to the next say development in flexible mesh, a 3D baroclinic transport model. This was actually a development as part of a research study that we did for the purpose of long-term ecological and water quality modeling in the North Sea. We took the, say, the coarsened DCSM grid that I have just shown, and expanded that to a 3D model. So we added 20 equidistant sigma layers in this case. Later we want to expand that further. We use a K-epsilon turbulence closure model, and also we added some additional forcings. So for the lateral forcing, we had tight and inverse barometer correction, but we added temperature and salinity climatology, some monthly mean values from the World Ocean Atlas. For surface forcing, we already had the tidal potential and wind speed and pressure. Also, we switched from Heerlam to ECMWF era interim forcing because we want to do long-term impact studies, hindcast studies. But now also we added a heat flux model to account for exchange of temperature between water and atmosphere. And for that, parameters, dew point temperature, relative humidity, and cloud cover were added. And finally, we added freshwater discharges from the EHYPE model, from which we derived a climatology for, I think in this case, about 70 major rivers in the entire domain. This development is still ongoing. We just had the first results, And so it means it's not validated yet, but I have already made an animation. I'll show that here. On the left-hand side, you see surface salinity, and on the right-hand side, you see surface temperature. What is nice to see, you see it, this is just 1 month, yes, just one random month. You see, say, the movement of the tide, you see the day-night variability in temperature. I'll start it again. And what is also nice, previously we had coarser models for these kind of applications. Now it's more refined, and you see all these nice, say, spatial features, all these detailed features popping up. Eventually we want to even further refine, but this is already an improvement. Okay, the validation of this model is still ongoing and development, but I already want to say something about the scalability and the computational burden. On the top plot you can see the speed up, with on the horizontal axis the number of nodes. Each node has 4 computational cores. Perfect scaling would mean that it is shown with the diagonal dashed line. So 10 times more nodes would then mean 10 times faster model. What we achieve with this model is a 7 times speed up with 10 times more nodes, which is still excellent. But also, even more important, in the lower plot, I show the computational time required to run an entire year. Eventually, we want to run a couple of decades. But this is for 1 year. And this shows that if we go to, say, 10 nodes, which is really not that much, we achieve a computational time of 16 hours per year. This translates to about 2 to 3 minutes per day. So also for operational applications, this is very, very feasible. So typically you would run a couple of days forecast. So 2-3 minutes is really excellent then. And then finally something on 2D versus 3D and the occurrence of an annual M2 modulation. What you see here on the left-hand side is the quality of the tide representation that I also have shown earlier, with in the blue circles the major forecasting locations in the Netherlands. What you see here is the quality is excellent, but you see some spatial variability. So you see that especially towards the east, in the Eastern Bottom Sea, Eemsdalert estuary, the errors become a bit larger, and this is the station of Delfzijl, which is notorious in the Netherlands because it's difficult to do surge forecasting there, but also the tide is more difficult to forecast. On the right-hand side, in the top plot, I have shown the astronomic high water errors for an entire year. So these are only the tidal contributions to the high water errors for this year. And what you clearly see is that there is some scatter, but also clearly there is an annual variation there. And the immediate reaction could be, okay, this is because the SA, the annual constituent, is off, for example. But actually, this is not the case. In the lower plot, I have included only the semi-diurnal and diurnal constituents, so no low-frequency constituents like SA. And still, you see the same annual pattern there. And this appears to be a modulation of M2, so the presence of a tide that differs in frequency, say, by 1 cycle per year, plus or minus 1 cycle per year. Previous slide was for Delfzijl only. Here I show the contribution of this modulation, so this annual behavior, to the total tide error for the Dutch stations. And there you can see that the contribution of this phenomenon to the error is, say, 10, 20, 25% in most locations, but up to 50% in DelfSail, shown on the right-hand side. So clearly, if we want to improve, say, the tide forecasts there, we have to do something about it. So the previous slide was the contribution to the model error. Here I only look at the measurements and the magnitude of the modulation that is evident from the measurements. On the left-hand side for the entire shelf, on the right-hand side for the Dutch stations, so you can see that it varies over the shelf, but there's a number of regions where it is quite large, for example in the Western Scheldt, but also say in the Severn estuary, a station like Sheerness, but also the north of the Netherlands, the German Bight. There the magnitude of this modulation is plus or minus 5-6 centimeters. Of course, the question is, to what extent can we capture this with our 2D barotropic models? I'll try to explain that here. What we did here is we analyzed 19 years of data by doing an harmonic analysis with a window length of 3 months and every time shifted that by 1 month. All these resulting M2 amplitudes were averaged for each month, and that is what you show, what is shown here in this graph. So for every month, the amplitude, and in this case, it is divided by the average amplitude. So you see the mean amplitude ratio here varying over the year in red for the measurements. What we also found is that the seasonal behavior has two components, an annual cycle in the middle plot and a semi-annual cycle in the lower plot. And what you can see in black, these are the 2D barotropic model results. You see that the semi-annual cycle is very, very well captured. The annual cycle is not. So we see that the amplitude is off by 50% and the timing is completely wrong. And the question now is, can we do this better with the 3D model? So here I only focus on the annual cycle. Again, in red the measurements, in the dashed line the reference, so the 2D barotropic model, and in the solid black line the 3D baroclinic model, including stratification of temperature and salinity that I just presented. And what you see here is that the amplitude of this modulation increases with 50%, or actually doubles, and has exactly the right magnitude. Only the timing is still improves a slight bit, but is still a bit off. So this shows that it could be important to use a 3D model even for tide forecasting. Of course, for water quality, ecology, morphology, etc., it is common practice, but even for forecasting, it can be important. And crucially, I've also shown that with 2-3 minutes computational time per day, it is definitely also feasible in an operational environment. Of course, these were just initial results. We have not yet validated it, etc. So we still want to improve the timing of this cycle. But again, this shows the potential benefit for tide surge forecasting. And with that, I want to go to the summary and conclusions. First of all, on the model development and the skill assessment, I have presented a completely redesigned new generation tide surge model, two actually, the Dutch Continental Shelf Model version 6, and also a model with further refinement in the Dutch estuaries and Waddenzee, DCSM Zuno. With year-long simulations, I've shown excellent agreement with measurements. Say for the Dutch coastal stations, we have an RMS of the total water level of, say, 6-7 centimeters, which is almost 50% improvement to the previous generation model. And also for the Dutch estuaries, we saw an added benefit of further refining the model. So we saw a further 25% improvement. What was crucial in getting this excellent quality was really the resolution, but also a rigorous reduction of uncertainty in the time-independent parameters. We also developed a steady-state Kalman filter. This has an acceptable computational burden and is implemented to improve the forecast for the shorter lead times. And again, with year-long hindcast simulations, we have shown an improvement in the water level representation, both at the Kalman filter locations, but also further upstream. And crucially, the Kalman filter also successfully improves the forecasts up to 12 to 18 hours in advance, also shown in a real live event. Then onto the new opportunities with flexible mesh. I have shown that the conversion to a flexible mesh leads to only very limited differences in tide propagation. By coarsening the grid only at places where local spatial scales allow it, the computational speed can be increased by a factor 3 to 4 with virtually no loss in accuracy. I also presented some ongoing work on a 3D hydrodynamic transport model. And finally, with a better representation of the M2 annual modulation and also excellent computational efficiency, this 3D model shows potential for tide surge forecasting applications. And with that, I would like to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you, Fabien. And to our audience, thank you for participating and attending this webinar. We hope you enjoyed this event. The webinar recordings and presentation slides will be available next week via both the Deltares Academy website and via the Delft 3D open source website. If you have any questions, comments or feedback, please contact us via our email address academy@deltares.nl. Thank you again for participating and see you at our next webinar. Now we will stop the recordings. However, for those who have questions for the speaker today, there's an opportunity to put your verbal questions to Fermijn and to our panel right now.